Good morning. Always seems like there's one more last minute thing to do. I'm sure I've forgotten something, but good morning. Delighted to say, good morning, boy. There's a unmistakable greeting. I appreciate hearing it, truly. Well, it's the end of January, too, already. My goodness. Well, almost the end of January. That was quick. Christmas was like more than a month ago and stuff. Can you believe it? I can't either. And it's almost time for Lent. We'll be going into Lent here very soon on Valentine's Day, of all curious days. And that's coming up soon. Strangest January I can ever remember in my life. We got about that much of January, and then all the rest is kind of late March. We were driving home from St. Cloud last night, and the fog was so terrible. We were, the last 8 miles down County 8, we were crawling along about 30 miles an hour, and even at that speed, I was hoping we weren't going to hit anything. It was just, you could see the dash in the road that you were next to, and then about the next one, and that was about it. So it was really dense and treacherous, but home safe and sound, and glad to be here this morning. Lots going on. Wife, dear, did you want to make some announcement about, you forgot? My wife will give us a brief announcement about Bible study and such.
The women's Bible study for February, I moved it, it's going to be February 8th, Thursday at 6:30. We are going to continue our theme from last month, which was servanthood and a servant's heart. And so I want to make Valentine's for the healthcare center. So we're going to meet at 6:30. We're going to make Valentine's, and then I will deliver them. And then after that, we'll keep meeting the first Thursday at 6:30. Love to have more women. We just have a great time. It's a wonderful Bible study. So please join us if you can. Thank you.
Thank you, my dear. So, women's Bible study. Oh, we're delighted. We're having today is a brunch day at the parsonage, and Bruce and Ava Jean are going to be with us, and Doug and Sue Dames, just delighted to have them. And I see that the Taylors are going to join us next month, and that'll be wonderful as well. We'll have a new sign-up sheet for the March and April dates very shortly, so please keep that in mind. The parsonage brunch is just a good time. You don't get a second sermon, I promise, and I'm not going to try to sell you Amway or anything. We just sit down and we eat some eggs and we talk smart for, a little while. It's just a good time, just opportunity to, get better acquainted and enjoy fellowship. Well, we have special music. We've got our young people today. They're going to lead us in song, and I believe the bulletin says we start with special music with the pre-K to fourth graders. Have I got that right? I see you gals conferring. So, okay. Well, let us begin then, and bring up the youngsters for the music. The stage is yours. As they're filing up, I'll also remind, right after special music, as you'll see in the bulletin, we're going to install all of our new officers, and so all of those of you who are present, who have just been elected, I'll have you up after that. So we'll let the kids clear, and then we'll do installation. Thank you.
be careful, let your ears what you hear. For the Father up above is looking down with love. So be careful, little ears, what you hear. Oh, be careful, little tongue, what you say. Oh, be careful, little tongue, what you say. For the Father up above.
Not sure where to go from there. You've heard calling, you've heard confession and absolution, you've heard a sermon. We've got more who showed up to sing, so we want to let them have the opportunity. Well, at this time, oh, and thank you, children, thanks again. Let's one more time for those youngsters. Well done, well done. All newly elected officers, I will be calling you up in just one moment. We have a little prayer statement. In holy baptism, we are set apart for the mission and ministry of Christ's church, to serve in our own unique ways using the talents and gifts that God entrusted to us. As Jesus commissioned his disciples after his resurrection, saying, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." Amen. Will all elected officers who are present, newly elected officers who are present, please rise and join me up front. We have Chris Leske, who will be transitioning from the trustee board and has accepted and been elected the position of vice chair, and my wife, who's going to be our deacon of worship and music. Pam Antonsen, back once again. It's like the mafia, you know. You think you're out, and they suck you back in. Oh, because of me? Oh, boy. What a reason. Judy and Sue Dames is joining worship and music. That's great. So delighted to have you all here. The following brothers and sisters in the faith have been elected by this congregation to serve Christ's mission in a capacity of leadership for the good of the entire faith community. We have them now forward for your consideration. Concerning our mutual ministry in Christ and our calling to serve, St. Paul writes in his letter to Ephesians, "I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. He gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to full maturity, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ." From Paul's letter to Ephesians. And so I will, let me step forward, excuse me, Chris, step forward now. I've got a couple of questions to ask, and as I ask them, if you would, please respond by saying, "I will," and I ask God to help me. So, will you accept these positions of leadership and responsibility within Zion Lutheran Church in submission to the Word of God? Will you strive to be an example of the Christian faith and life by your daily witness and by your faithful participation in worship through word and sacrament? Will you promote harmony in this faith community and use your God-given gifts in service to the Lord's mission by striving to be faithful disciples of Christ in the positions to which you have been called to serve? People of Zion Lutheran Church, will you, as the people of God, by our Lord's grace and mercy, pray for and uphold and support these brothers and sisters in their positions of leadership in this congregation? We will, and we ask God to help us. May the Lord, who has given you the will to do these things, graciously give you the strength and spirit to carry them out. You are thereby and herefore, by the power of the Holy Spirit, commissioned and installed as leaders of our congregation. Let us pray. Gracious God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, you have called these people to serve in leadership roles in the parish, to work together for the mission and ministry of this congregation, and to encourage all the baptized to live faithfully. Bless them and their work by pouring out your Holy Spirit upon them. Give them your holy wisdom. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Folks, let's welcome our new leaders with our applause. Thank you. You can be seated. Well, we have opening hymns, and I think we will be led by Carrie Ann's group of singers. Here they come.
Father, I adore you. I've been. Washed by the water, I've been. Cleansed by the sea, I've been. Touched by the river of eternity. Though I don't understand it, I have never been the same. I can't turn back the water of change. The rivers, they run, the rivers, they roll away. The voice of life whispers every day. At the heart of it all, everyone wants to be free. Free to live, free to love, for eternity. I'm washed by the water, I've been cleansed by the sea, I've been touched by the river of eternity. Though I don't understand it, I have never been the same. I can't turn back the water of change. I wonder aloud where in the world I might be. Had the cross not been shown to me, it's opened my heart. Made me look outside and see. I can no longer live for only me. I've been washed by the water, I've been cleansed by the sea, I've been touched by the river of eternity. Though I don't understand it, I have never been the same. I can't turn back the water of change. Washed by the water, I've been cleansed by the sea, I've been touched by the river of eternity. Though I don't understand it, I have never been the same. I can't turn back the water of change.
Well done, thank you. And so we continue then, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. From the letter of 1 John, we read that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. The truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is merciful and just, will cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. And so now, in a moment of silence, let's take that time to confess unto God what troubles our hearts this day. And so we pray, most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. And so now, as a member with you in the priesthood of all believers, but by the authority of Jesus Christ our Lord, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Pray with me now our prayer of the day. O God, you know the perilous choices we are prone to make that fall short of your desire for human faithfulness and obedience. Without you, our fragile nature cannot survive. Support us with your word of truth, that we may grow in faith in the midst of our trials. Grant this, we pray, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We will have our readings then.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first reading is from Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15 through 20. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen, just as you desired of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, "Let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, or see this great fire any more, lest I die." And the Lord said to me, "They are right in what they have spoken. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him. And whoever will not listen to my words that he shall speak in my name, I myself will require it of him. But the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name that I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that same prophet shall die." The word of the Lord. We'll now do the Psalm 111 responsively. Hallelujah. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the assembly of the upright, in the congregation.
Great are the deeds of the Lord. They are studied by all who delight in him.
His work is full of majesty and splendor, and his righteousness endures forever. He gives food to those who fear him. He is ever mindful of his covenant.
He has shown his people the power of his works, giving them the lands of the nations.
The works of his hands are faithfulness and justice. All his commandments are sure. He sent redemption to his people. He commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 13. Concerning food offered to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. This knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. If anyone imagines that he knows something, he does not yet know as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God, he is known by God. Therefore, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that an idol has no real existence, and that there is no God but one. For although there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as indeed there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. However, not all possess this knowledge, but some, through former association with idols, eat food as really offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not commend us to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this right of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if anyone sees you who have knowledge eating in an idol's temple, will he not be encouraged, if his conscience is weak, to eat food offered to idols? And so by your knowledge, this weak person is destroyed, the brother for whom Christ died. Thus, sinning against your brothers and wounding their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food makes my brother stumble, I will never eat meat lest I make my brother stumble. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, Pam. Will you all please rise then for a reading of our Holy Gospel? Today we read from the Gospel of Mark from the first chapter. Jesus and Simon and Andrew and James and John went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, Jesus entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority, and not as the scribes. And immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. And they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And at once his fame spread everywhere throughout all the surrounding region of Galilee. The word of our Lord. Won't you be seated? Well, grace and peace to you from God, our Heavenly Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Today's gospel lesson gives us Mark's story of the beginning of the ministry now of Jesus Christ. In the first 20 verses of his gospel, Mark introduced John the Baptist to us, described the holy baptism, noted the driving of Jesus into the wilderness for the 40 days of tempting, and then now finally has brought him to Galilee to start proclaiming good news and recruiting his apostle team. All that in 20 verses. Mark has been very expeditious, I would say, in setting his table. But now he will gradually slow his pace. And yet, as I read Mark, his sense of urgency will build. Mark brings us now to Capernaum. It is just at sundown, which is the beginning of the Sabbath, and which is when they went to synagogue. And Jesus has now entered that synagogue. Mark tells us that he began to teach, and that his teaching astonished his hearers. Mark does not tell us what he was teaching. Mark's emphasis is not on that content, but on the power of Jesus to teach and on his authority to be the teacher. Now, this is Mark's angle on the Jesus story. This is the Messiah, because only the Messiah could have this kind of power and authority. In contrast, Matthew, he never tells this story explicitly, but kind of covers its point more generally and more near the end of his chapter 4. And there we hear Matthew's first comments, in fact, on miraculous works of Jesus, healing diseases, driving out demons. But Matthew's treatment is really more like a footnote. In my humble opinion, this might be because healing and driving out of demons and even resurrections had also been performed by the prophets. Elijah and Elisha come to mind. So, such miracles, for Matthew perhaps, may not necessarily have been irrefutable evidence of the true Messiah. Well, anyway, Luke does tell the story in very similar detail as to Mark, but like Matthew, he gets to it later in his chapter 4 as well. And that is also Luke's first mention of a miraculous work. But to my mind, that's really kind of how Luke presents it. It's just a first of many miracles. He does this one, and everyone was amazed. And then 2 verses later, he's healing Peter's mother-in-law at her house. So Luke launches into this string of miracle stories that will stretch into his next 5 chapters. Here's one, here's another, and so on. Luke's approach to the Jesus story, as he tells us at the very beginning of his work, is to give a full and orderly account of the story. Mark's beginning says that he's beginning the gospel, but Luke calls it an accounting. Luke is an historian, where Mark is more a preacher. John never tells the story in any manner, specific or general. John's first reported miracle is the changing of water into wine at the wedding in Cana, and then in the rest of his gospel, only 7 more miracle moments are even described. Some scholars insist there are only 6, but I'm not going to go into that today. Mark, though, uses this story as an opening. It is meant to be taken as a big opening. A hard-hitting revelation, a first proclamation that God's chosen one has come and is here and acting. This probably doesn't hit us that hard. We've all grown up in and live in a multimedia world, endeavoring to be ever more spectacular and shocking to us. Our sense of surprise, I think, has been blunted, perhaps, by the onslaught. But this opening of Mark's would have hit his first readers like a big, bold, front-page headline. Pearl Harbor bombed, that big. Twin Towers toppled. Well, we'll get back to our narrative here. In the synagogue on this Sabbath are the scribes. They're the usual teachers of the ancient scriptures. They belong there. And a congregation of Jews, all the good folk of Capernaum. And they, of course, belong there too. And a demon-possessed man. And now I'm all kind of set up to say he doesn't belong there, but actually, I'm not going to say that. The demon-possessed man is in the story. Mark gives us this. Oh, and let me tell you, there are reams and reams of scholarly works on why and what and wherefore on that, but I'm not going to dive into them either today. But a demon present in the synagogue. Maybe now we are a little uncomfortable. Surely Mark is not suggesting that evil belonged there. I'm not standing here in the pulpit this morning to say so either. Yet evil was there. Evil comes to our places of worship. And why wouldn't it? I mean, think about that. The synagogue, the temple, the church. Any of these is a battlefront for the evil one. We gather on our Sabbath days to be lifted up by our Lord, to be strengthened and fortified. If evil can come in and mess that up when we are gathered in numbers, well, then we are easier prey when we're alone in our homes with our TVs on and our smartphones in our hands, tuned in to that world of dazzling desirables. Divide and conquer, as the old saying goes, and that works as well for evil. Well, anyway, a demon-possessed man is present. And this demon speaks from the man to challenge Jesus. He calls Jesus out by name. Now, this is very old ancient rhetoric. Calling out your enemy by name was to assert dominance over him. And it was used as a strategy because it worked. Well, I remember when I was a kid, my mother would call to me. Now, you know, if I was coming in the kitchen door right after school, I would always say, "Hi, Mom," and then she'd just say, "Hi, boy." What I wouldn't give to hear that said again. If I was in the house and she needed me for something, then she would say, "Brian," you know, kind of with that question mark right on the end. But then when I heard, "Brian Edward Lauer," oh no, I would have that moment of panicked fear. Oh, what she got on me? Who ratted me out? Now, whether it was her intention or not, I rather think it probably was, but whether or not, my panic and fear gave her the upper hand. So, that's the demon. He's taken his one and only shot. But the panicked fear is in the accuser this time. Jesus is not subdued. He tells the demon to be silent. Actually, his words were not even that polite. As you all know, Mark's gospel was written in Greek. And the Greek word Mark actually used here is thymoo, which means to muzzle. It's a word used for animals. We recall the verse from Deuteronomy about not muzzling the ox as he treads out the grain. Y'all remember that. Well, it's the same word used here. And it would have been insulting to apply to people. So, "Muzzle it and get out," was Jesus' command, and that command was instantly obeyed. Jesus is positioned in this story as greater than all of them who were present. His teaching more powerful than the scribes. His authority instantly obeyed. We have people in witness to what Jesus said and then did, and it causes them to question among themselves what it is that they had witnessed. It was teaching, but it struck them in an entirely new way. Whatever Jesus said, it was something they weren't used to. It was nothing any scribe ever told them. And from it, they discerned authority. Now that's more than just hearing. They'd been listening to scribes for Sabbaths going back beyond memory. Never before had they felt that they'd been called out by name. Never before were they struck by what they'd heard and seen. This was new. Extraordinary. This was unprecedented. Authority goes deeper into us than our ears and our eyes. When real authority is present, we feel it. We know it in our consciousness. Maybe we fear it, maybe we rejoice in it, but it reaches in and it grabs us. Changes us in the moment. Well, as long as I've already started the Greek lesson, let me give you one more. Exousia. Exousia means authority, but more than the sense of exercising a power, but rather in the sense of innate power, or in other words, the origin of power. Exousia. This is the word Mark used when the people cried out, "A new teaching with authority." This man read the old and familiar words of the Torah and somehow claimed them with authority, claimed them as words that were his words to teach. The people felt it, knew it in the moment. And then this man commanded an unclean spirit to leave, and it obeyed instantly. And these people were astonished, overwhelmed by true God revealed. But Mark does not give us their conclusions. We hear only their astonishment. They discerned power and authority, but we don't know how they digested it. Not yet. We will learn that in the ensuing scripture. Now this stands in the moment, though, in contrast to that unclean spirit who also discerned it, knew it in an instant, but did not ponder the newness, didn't need to consider the authority, the exousia of this teaching, but exclaimed what he knew. This man is the Holy One of God. And it also knew unmistakably what that meant, that this one had come. Mark's entire gospel does provide a Matthew argument, but was not written to argue. Does provide a Lucan history, but it was not written to be a history. It is proclamation. It is an invitation to us to join in the progression of the Jesus story, to participate with Jesus and his apostles in a journey of urgency, to experience the labor of greatest love that is the very creation of a gospel. The gospel of our Lord God, given through his beloved and only begotten Son. The good news sent to be experienced by you, lived in you, created for you. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now may the peace that surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Youngsters, will you please come up and lead us? We have a hymn today for you to sing.
last year. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand, I fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and save. Lord, I need you.
Such a beautiful prayer. I just love that song. Love that song. Well, will you all stand now together? And it is time for us to declare our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I'm going to kind of straddle my house guests here for today. And so we proclaim together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Let's share together a sign of that peace this morning.
Peace.
Mix it up.
We all have to agree with you.
Taylor does it on purpose.
I do.
He does it on purpose.
She doesn't want us to.
Thank you.
Everybody's got something to offer. Young and old, the prince and the pauper. Everybody's got something to offer. In the name of the Lord. To the lost and the lowly ones, the message, it is clear. We have all got a gift to give. Our hands, our hearts, our tears. Everybody's got something to offer. Young and old, the prince and the pauper. Everybody's got something to offer. In the name of the Lord. To believers gathered here, the message, it is true. We have all got a gift to give, in all we say and do. Everybody's got something to offer. Young and old, the prince and the pauper. Everybody's got something to offer. In the name of the Lord.
Let's continue then with our offering prayer. Lord, we thank you for the many gifts you have given us. Teach us to use them in charity and compassion, in stewardship and service to others. Through your Holy Spirit, give us awareness of your mercies, that with truly thankful hearts we may praise you on our lips and in our lives, that we may give ourselves to your service, that we may walk in your ways holy, and by the righteousness of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So let us continue now to pray for our communities and for people in the whole world. Wise and good Heavenly Father, help us to acknowledge you as the source of all wisdom, and not to lean on our own understandings. We praise your holy name for giving us the freedom to come to you through prayer in all matters and at all times. Your word is faithful and trustworthy, so let us be guided by your steadfast ways in all that we do. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, you provide for all our needs, both body and soul. Create in us a grateful heart to receive all that you provide and to praise you through meaningful worship together. Teach us to be more Christ-like in all we do, that we may continue to build up your church for the sake of the world. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty Lord, you are a wise and generous God, and we pray for the wisdom of all elected leaders in our church, our community, our state, and in the nation. We ask for your guidance and continued presence with them as they make decisions concerning your people. We also pray for their well-being, and that they would be of sound mind and body, so that they may do their important work. Lord, in your mercy. Father God, you know our pain and our struggles that no one else can see. You know our needs. Today we pray for the comfort of all your children, especially today we remember Dee Dee and Ricky and Kurt and Tom and Don and Ken, John, Roger, and Ardell. And we remember those in care centers like Phyllis and Bob, Zelda and Marianne, Doris, Wes, Ruth, and Mabel, and those that we now remember in our hearts and on our lips. And today, Lord, we remember also the family of Bobby Bulow as they grieve Bobby's passing of this weekend. Lift all of them, Lord, lift them up to you, that they may gain strength in the knowledge of your promise of eternal life. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now we will sing together the words our Savior taught us. Bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our final hymn, we're going to sing together, Great is the Lord. Youngsters, lead us out.
Great is the Lord, he is holy and just, by his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true, by his mercy he proves his love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory, great is the Lord and worthy of praise. By his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true. By his mercy he proves his love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory. Great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great is the Lord, now lift up your voice. Now lift up your voice. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord.
Go in peace and serve our great Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Go high.